Good evening, everyone. Let's stand and sing. Stand up for Jesus, standing on the promises, and He lives. Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal
Bishop and Mrs. Watson, Bishop Norris, Bishop Holston, members of the cabinet, our youth delegation, sisters and brothers in Christ. We welcome you this evening in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as we gather for this time of worship, celebration, and thanksgiving. We come to worship a God who has blessed this conference and who in his time lifts up the leadership for ministry in this place we call North Georgia. We come to celebrate 150 years of the North Georgia Conference, the victories that we have won, the challenges that we have faced, the experiences from which we have grown, and the opportunities with which we will be presented in the next 150 years. We come to give thanks for our ministry together with Bishop Watson and Margaret over the last 8 years. We regret that the entire Watson family could not be with us tonight, but we are thankful that daughter Elizabeth Riddle and the Riddle grandchildren, Camilla Watson and Emmeline Margaret, are here to share this time together. Elizabeth, would y'all stand and let us give you a North Georgia welcome. They've been over there waving at Grandma and Grandpa. Ministry is not a one-person opportunity. We are all in ministry together, but there must be strong leadership. Tonight, we give thanks for that strong leadership in the person of Mike Watson. God truly placed the right person in the right place at the right time. Over the last 8 years under Bishop Watson's leadership, as a conference, our debt has been substantially reduced. Our membership has grown. Bridges have been built around the world, and our faith has been deepened. Bishop Watson, we give thanks for your leadership. We give thanks for 8 years that we have shared with you and Margaret. And most of all, we give thanks for the fact that God has allowed our paths to cross.
Let us now go to God in prayer. Father God, the words of the song still ring around this building, and they ring in our hearts that we are indeed standing on the promises of God. And this evening we come into this place to celebrate the ministry of Bishop Mike Watson and his wife, Miss Margaret Watson. Father God, you have let them come in our midst for the last 8 years. You have showed them the way church leadership should be. They have led both with grace and compassion, and they have shown the traits that you laid out in Timothy. Father God, that they should lead with a heart, a servant's heart, that they only both got from their love of Jesus Christ. Father God, we thank you for that love tonight. We thank you for their ministry. Thank you for allowing them to be with us. For it's in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Good evening, Bishop Norris and Bishop Holston, and good evening to your lovely wives, Dr. Mackie Norris and Mrs. Felicia Holston. North Georgia, it is an honor to stand before you this evening to pay tribute to Bishop B. Michael Watson and Mrs. Margaret Watson, on behalf of the 1,400-plus clergy in the North Georgia Conference. Bishop Watson, according to the Book of Discipline, a bishop leads through the following disciplines. One, a vital and renewing spirit, an inquiring mind, and a commitment to the teaching office, a vision for the church, a prophetic commitment for the transformation of the church and the world, a passion for the unity of the church, and lastly, the ministry of administration. Bishop Watson, for the last 8 years, you have exemplified excellent leadership in these six disciplines. Time does not permit for me to highlight every discipline, but I would like to commend you in leading this annual conference in the first discipline, a vital and renewing spirit. The role of the bishop is to faithfully practice, model, and lead the spiritual disciplines of our faith, and to call and inspire the clergy and the laity within the church to practice the Christian disciplines in their individual lives through the tradition of personal holiness. Bishop, you challenged us as an annual conference and a cabinet to be spiritual leaders. North Georgia, my challenge to you is, how can we lead the church, be bound for greater things, if we are not actively engaged in our spiritual disciplines? In addition, Bishop, you engaged the annual conference by challenging us to read the Bible and say, I say yes, read the Bible every year, and you even challenged us to read it in different translations. You equipped the cabinet by providing several tools of learning, the Rule of Benedict, the Moravian Daily Text, and the prayer guide to center our time of meetings. And also, you all traveled to the Holy Land with clergy, laity, and recent ordinands to walk and reflect upon the steps of our Lord and Savior. But Bishop, I think one of the greatest things that you did was that on June 16, 1973, you stood before God, family, and friends, and married Margaret Lee. And Bishop, both of you vowed to each other for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish. Mrs. Watson, we thank you. We thank you for your radiant smile, your graciousness, your uniqueness, and your active support of the clergy spouses. I firmly believe that not only the clergy person is called, but their spouses have a unique and special call given by God to walk this journey. And lastly, as Skip mentioned, Elizabeth, in the absence of your brother Ben, the five grandchildren, in which three are here tonight, Camilla, Watson, and Emmeline, you're here tonight, and we, the North Georgia Conference, we thank you. We thank you for allowing your parents to affect our lives for the last 8 years. If you know anything about Bishop and Margaret, their children and grandchildren are precious in their lives. North Georgia clergy and spouses, and I'm going to even ask for children of clergy, will you please stand with me? Bishop, on behalf of North Georgia clergy, spouses, and the children, we want to extend our love, support, and our prayers. As you all move to the next assignment that God has carved out for you, may your witness together be a continuous blessing as you represent the United Methodist Church as its next ecumenical officer, and as you often say, glory, hallelujah. And you also say, and so it is, let it be. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Whenever clouds arise, when songs give place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to him. From care he sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Your heart be troubled. His tender words I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubt and fear. Though by the path he leadeth, his one step I may see. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because
evening. I stand as the conference lay leader on behalf of more than 360,000 United Methodists in this conference who wish to express their deep gratitude to Margaret and Mike Watson for their service among us as our Episcopal leaders. This evening, I would like to share with you a little bit of what's been on my mind as I think about how the laity of this conference might pay tribute to you. Sharma Lewis and I were clear that this would not be a roast, but rather a serious time to honor you all in a very meaningful and serious way, for you have indeed served us with excellence. In 2004, Dr. Thomas Frank and Dr. Russell Ritchie published a book titled The Episcopacy in the Methodist Tradition, a handy little reference for me as I was preparing remarks in your honor this evening. In the tradition of the Church of England, bishops are officers of the church and historically derive some measure of authority from a monarch. Similarly, in the Roman Catholic tradition, bishops are appointed by a pope and derive some power from the pope himself, and in fact are considered princes of the church. Tonight we gather not to honor the ministry only of a bishop of the church. We stand here tonight not to honor a prince of the church, but indeed a prince of a human being. We gather at this annual conference for this occasion. It is, I think, appropriate, however, to remember that we people called Methodists have gathered at conferences like this for generations to consider bishops. We do so even now. When the preachers hailed from across the country to gather for the Christmas conference, for example, in 1784, they doubtless convened expecting some ecclesial deliverance from John Wesley. Their expectations and concerns, at least as we discern them, focus less on some grand ecclesial design and more on day-to-day problems which they faced in their day, primarily a lack of access to the sacraments and ordination. And insofar as they had hinted at their interest in an ecclesial design that had shown a predilection for something other than an established episcopacy, we don't know. Except that just some years prior, 5 years in fact, in 1779, in the absence of Francis Asbury, these same preachers, or something close to them, gathered for conference and had pronounced as a body that the episcopal establishment should be dissolved. It was some wonder then that by the time the Christmas conference convened, that they had given way to the establishment of an episcopal form of government. Under the direction of superintendents, elders, deacons, and helpers. Then, of course, there is the election of Coke and Asbury to the office of general superintendent, which it's unclear what Mr. Wesley may have thought about this. However, it is interesting that by the time that the discipline published by Coke and Asbury came about in 1789, they were careful to note early in the chapters there that nothing has been introduced into Methodism at present, including an episcopal form of government, which was not before fully exercised by Mr. Wesley himself. It is no wonder, then, that there was then and remains today some discomfort with the establishment of a form of leadership in the church that we know today as the bishops. In fact, as I reported on Tuesday, and as recently as the 2016 General Conference, we continue to wrestle with what this looks like in our own denomination as a United Methodist Church today. In preparing these remarks, I didn't focus so much on the question of how we got bishops, but rather I ask, what do you do with a bishop on the occasion of their retirement? What words are appropriate? What gifts are respectable? What tributes might be appropriate? What I do know is this. I give thanks to God for Margaret and Mike Watson. I first encountered the Watsons at the 2000 General Conference and later that summer at the 2000 Southeastern Jurisdictional Conference. Mike Watson was the first person I recall making a conscious decision to vote for into the office of bishop. And as we all know, this was not a wasted vote. This tribute is necessarily personal for me because, you see, since that time, I've enjoyed a deeply personal relationship with this family. Getting to know Mike and Margaret well over these many years, sharing a common connection now with the Riddles, who have scattered, it would appear. One Riddle remains. Camilla, thank you. Susan and I are godparents to Watson Riddle, a friendship we share that binds our families together in a very, very special way. Zach Riddle, Bishop Watson's son-in-law, and I get confused for one another so often, it's gotten to be ridiculous. And as I said, our families enjoy this friendship that blossomed from that time in 2000 when we became acquainted, and for that I will ever be grateful. There was nothing like the day that our daughter was born. I'll remember it for the rest of my life. And one of the first people through the hospital door after our families came to see us was Mike Watson, there to offer a pastoral prayer to celebrate this high holy time in our life and to be with us some months later for the baptism of our daughter into the Christian church. And we hope with your leading and example that we might shepherd her further into the Christian walk in faith as she seeks to be a follower of Jesus Christ. So too the laity of this annual conference benefit from your spiritual and ecclesial leadership. So too we benefit from the example that you and Margaret have set for us as a husband and wife team leading in mission and ministry, indeed all over the world. We're better connected to our Methodist family in the United States and indeed abroad. We have a better sense of what it means to be global citizens. We have a better sense of what it means as laity and clergy to be ecumenical in thought, word, and deed, and to think more intentionally about those actions on behalf of Christ and the church we serve. We indeed have learned to read more thoughtfully and deeply under your leadership. You've guided us as a shrewd business person, one who knows real estate, one who knows finances of large, complex organizations, and more will be said tomorrow during the budget presentation about your wise counsel that set us on firm financial footing. Firm financial footing that not only looks good on a balance sheet, but I am convinced, sir, will translate into mission and ministry opportunities for this conference for generations to come. For these things and for many more, we owe you a great debt, sir. Thank you for what you've meant to us. Margaret, thank you for your time with us. There is no measure of gratitude we can express that's adequate this evening. We love you. Thank you.
Bishop Watson, it has been my privilege to live in a city and in a state where you have been the bishop. And I've taught many, many student clergy who are here. And it is also my privilege to think that they've served under a bishop like you. So in order to honor you, because you love to sing, I've composed a hymn, and we're going to sing it as a congregation in his honor. And I want you to take the words to heart, especially filled with expectation and hope, still alive, yet restless. Yet restless. So this hymn, we invite you to stand and sing. The third stanza will slow down the text just a little bit, and Ralph Freeman will be assisting us. Please stand.
Jesus, all that loves and be seated.
Bishop Watson, we have for you this evening a set of four gifts. And I think it's probably going to be easier if you and Margaret might stay there. And I've got some assistants who can help me in this presentation. And we'll bring the gifts to you. Would that be okay? Good. So I'll invite Skip Madsen and Bill Martin and Don Saliers to come help me with this. The first gift I think we would like to present is a gift from Don Saliers himself, who just introduced this beautiful hymn to you. And we have for you a copy of this hymn that's been framed for your enjoyment later.
You need to hear the text since it didn't get on the board. Holy Spirit, come among us, give us strength to seek God's will. Filled with hope and expectation, we're alive, but restless still. Search our hearts and speak your word to us that we may come alive again, loving, wise, and faithful people, serving all your vast domain. For the gifts of life, we praise you, all that comes from your good hand, earth and air and water flowing, bread from wheat by human hands. For the wonder of creation and your holy history, too, in the great procession glorious, men and women sent from you. For the means of grace, we praise you, preaching, praying, song and meal, bath of water, spirit-giving, oil anointing, hands that heal. Send us to this world with blessing, that your church may work and pray for your kingdom seen in Jesus. All God loves and holds this day. Holy Spirit, breath of God's life, prophets, fire, our guide and light, bring us all to living memory, each in Jesus' touch and sight. Every sense of love and justice sanctifying in this place, inspiration, power, and passion, Christ shines out of every face. Thank you, Bishop Watson.
We have also for you, Margaret, a crystal vase that is at this point unfilled, but with the help of Bishop Watson in the months and years to come, we expect it'll be filled generously with flowers in tribute to you. We're going to advance those flowers to you to help you out here, but a recognition for Margaret and a word of appreciation. And lastly, Bishop Watson and Margaret, we, as a North Georgia Conference, have paid close attention to your generosity in directing contributions that you've received throughout your term as bishop, not just the 8 years you've been here, but indeed the 8 years you served in the South Georgia area as well, to various mission and ministry projects and scholarship funds across our connection. This generosity of yours has been indeed noticed. And in a tribute to this, we have collected an offering as a gift for you this evening, a part of which we'd like to present to you now on behalf of the laity and the clergy of the North Georgia Annual Conference with our gratitude.
Let's see if you can sing this time. Would you stand?
I know not why. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Most holy and loving God, on this happy and spirit-filled occasion, we gather in your presence to give thanks for the ministry of Bishop Mike and Margaret Watson. For 8 years, they have loved us, led us, taught us, and inspired us. They have been faithful to the multitude of traditions. They have lived at full stretch the spiritual gift of joy. They have called us to be our best selves. They have encouraged us in our daily devotion to your holy word. They have led by example. They have held us accountable. And they have done it with grace, always speaking truth. They have imagined, and may I add, traversed, new bridges for ministry all over our world. And with great care, they have urged us to cross bridges into new relationships with sisters and brothers in new places. For all of these virtues of the office of bishop, for all these ways the Watsons have lived and worked among us, and for all that is to come in their lives and in our life as an annual conference, because they have been among us, with deep feelings of appreciation for them and for their ministry here, we give you thanks. For it is in the precious name of Jesus we pray and shout, glory, hallelujah, amen.
I do think that we have to respond. Have a seat just a minute. Margaret said they're saying, oh no. We have to tell you how deeply we have appreciated being allowed to be a part of the family of North Georgia. You have received us so graciously and so warmly and so lovingly in every way. We are grateful to you. This service started out with our dear friend Ralph singing his eyes on. Weren't we grateful for Ralph singing? He sang his eyes on the sparrow, and Margaret knows this. She's heard this too from my father's own lips. We used to take a road trip, I guess you call it. We didn't call it that. We called it just a vacation. My father would close his business. He was a sole proprietor of a real estate business. Well, he didn't really close because the secretary was there and took rents in and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, he was gone. And when he was gone, everything was much slower. But he would take off 2 to 3 weeks every year for as long as I remember in my childhood. And we would drive in the car all over the United States. You know that song, some of you, if you're old as I am, you remember, see the
new
in your
Chevrolet.
America is asking you to call or something like that. Well, we didn't.
New to you.
See, you don't know anything about that, do you? You can also
trust your car to. See, they don't know all that, but we know that. The bright red Texaco Star. We didn't have a Chevrolet, but we rode all over this country. And I really saw a great deal of the country. And after I got a little older, Mother and Daddy would take Margaret. And Margaret would join us, and we went all over the place. And in that experience, my father would often sing in the car. And he very often sang, "His eyes on the sparrow, and I know he watches me." I learned that song from hearing my father sing it. I learned it, and I learned to believe it. And it got deep inside of me. And you've heard him sing that too, very, very much. So Ralph, thank you for opening by singing his eyes on the sparrow. Matthew talked about Tom Frank writing that book. I just got to tell you one little story here. When I came to Candler School of Theology, Don, I didn't know what it was to be a theology student. I'd majored in finance and real estate at the University of Alabama, and I thought I was going to go into that business. God called me into the ministry, and Margaret's father, when we went home that night from church after that call had come and Margaret was there, her father said, "Do you think this is going to affect you?" And she said, "Well, it very well could." And it did. But when I went to Candler School of Theology, the very first day, the very first class was in Bishop's Hall. And we were in that big room down at the end of the hall up on the, 311, room 311, that's right. Down at the very end of the hall, the biggest room. And so we went in and sat down in the class, and it was the biggest room. So it was a big classroom with a lot of people. And I sat next to a guy. Now, I didn't know anybody there. I didn't know why I was there. I was like, I'm out of my element here. And the guy I sat next to became friendly, and as people did, and he said, "Where are you from?" I said, "I'm from Dothan, Alabama." And I said, "Where are you from?" He said, "Arkansas." I said, "Okay." He said, "Did you come from what undergraduate school?" I said, "The University of Alabama." And he said, "Oh, really?" And I said, "How about you?" He said, "Harvard." I said, "That's great." He said, "What was your major? Philosophy?" I said, "No, finance and real estate." I said, "How about you?" He said, "Oh, my degree's in philosophy and religion." I said, "Oh, okay." everything was being confirmed to me that I was in the wrong place. And then he said, "Your family in the church?" I said, "Well, yeah, they go to church." I said, "How about yours?" He said, "Oh, yes, my father's a pastor, a minister. My father's a minister." I said, "The United Methodist Church?" "Yes, my father's." I said, "What church?" He said, "Oh, he doesn't have a church now." I said, "Oh, really?" I said, "What does he do?" He said, "He's the bishop in Arkansas." And I thought, I just need to leave and go home. It was Tom Frank. And he and I became very, very close friends. And if you know, I don't think Tom really ever left Candler. I mean, he never left Emory. He got his PhD, and he taught, and he became the guru of the church about not only the episcopacy, but the order of the church and all of that. And Tom and I, but that's the way I met Candler, with a student like Tom Frank. So when you quote Tom Frank tonight, I've been used to that for a long time. Ever since I started on this journey. He talked about our family, about Elizabeth and Camilla and Watson and Emmeline and Zach and our son Ben, who, I'm sorry, Zach and Ben, you know, they have to work. And so being here in the middle of the week was hard for them, so Zach couldn't be here, Ben couldn't be here, and our two oldest grandchildren. Our daughter-in-law, Angela, when I was elected on July the 12th, 13th, 14th, right in there, our our daughter-in-law, Angela, had just had our oldest grandson, Alex. He was born on July the 1st, and they were there at Lake Junaluska, with Alex being less, Camilla saying, ooh, so I mean, you hear the look on her face. Alex was there when I was elected, and he was less than 2 weeks old. And my mother was there, and that was so special. And Zach and Ben, our son and son-in-law, are so deeply involved in the church, it touches my heart. Zach has been a delegate to General Conference about 3 or 4 times, and was delegate to General Conference this time. And that's the way he and Matthew got to know each other, was through really the General Conference of the United Methodist Church as very, very young adults. And our son Ben, both Ben and Zach were on the North Alabama Episcopacy Committee for Will Willimon. They were both on the Episcopacy Committee, one going to the River Chase Church and one going to the Canterbury Church. And I asked Bishop Willimon one time, I said, is that legal? I said, you got my two sons. He said, they're not related. I said, well, they're really not. They're both married to our children. Ben is our son. That seems wrong to me some way. But both of them served on Bishop Willimon's Episcopus Committee, which was an interesting experience for both of them. And then the hymns that we sang tonight are also so very special. And Margaret's Yellow Roses, the last thing I'll say to you about Margaret's Yellow Roses, some of you may have heard this before, but when Margaret and I got married in June of 1973. June of 1973.
It is time to retire.
That's right. June of 1973. We flew from Dothan, where we got married at high noon on June. In June 16th. We flew from Dothan to Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And then we spent the night at an airport hotel. It's still there. It's not the same brand, but it's still there. And then we flew the next day to Hawaii for a honeymoon, which my parents had given us a Hawaiian honeymoon. Wasn't that pretty
that
good?
Was nice.
That was real good. And so, that I'd gone to the hotel before to make arrangements for the, what do they call that? The
honeymoon suite.
The honeymoon suite. And I had that there. And the woman at the hotel was so very nice. And I said, she really loves yellow roses. So I'd like to have a dozen yellow roses, maybe 2 dozen. Maybe one on either side of the bed at the bedside table and have the yellow roses. And that's what she really wants. And the lady was so nice, and she made all these arrangements. And so we flew in, and we went to the hotel, and the lady was not there because of the time of day we got there, the manager of the hotel. And so we went to the honeymoon suite. I carried her across the threshold.
No.
Sure I did. And so we got in the room, and there were 2 dozen roses, bright red. Bright red roses. And Margaret was nice about it. Oh, they're beautiful. I said, Margaret, I promise you, I promise you, they were supposed to be yellow. Yeah, sure, yeah, yeah. So the next morning, I went downstairs, and the manager of the hotel was there, the woman. And I said, she said, oh, how was everything? Was the room right? She was so gracious. And I said, yes, ma'am, it was just great. It was wonderful, but you know, what about those yellow roses? And she said, let me tell you, I went to the florist, and yellow roses cost so much more. She said, I knew you didn't want to spend that, so I got those red roses. I said, okay, thank you for the help. It was so helpful. Life has been fun. Ministry has been fun. I'm grateful that Margaret has been willing to let that night, August the 18th, 1968, when I accepted God's call to ministry, that she really accepted that too. And we were too young to know what we were doing. Her family didn't think that she knew what she was doing. Many of my family's friends did not think I knew what I was doing, and not doing that business and turning away from all of that, which was quite an operation there, and going into Christian ministry. But it has been the most remarkable thing. And the Church of Jesus Christ and the United Methodist Church has been better to us than we could possibly imagine. It has provided us more opportunities. It has taken us places we could have never imagined going. It has enabled us to have relationships with people who are God's very finest creation. And it has been such a joy for us. And so to be able to close that chapter in our lives out with North Georgia and with you has been just pure joy. That's the only way I know how to describe it. It's just been pure joy. And we thank you for it. I told them when they said, we're going to do this on is this Wednesday night? We're going to do this on Wednesday night. I said, people don't want to come back on Wednesday night. They don't want to come to a thing at, when they want their nights off at an annual conference. But you are gracious to have given up that free night to come and be with us and share with us in this. And we thank you very much. You want to say anything?
I just want you to know you have blessed us. And we thank you, and we will miss you. Bless you all.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
As you remain standing, we have a little bit of a change. You're going to get the chance to sing that song that we didn't sing. But first, we're going to do Blessed Assurance first, and then we're going to sing the song that you didn't sing, that Dr. Salier has put together so beautifully. And then I want to remind you that there will be a reception in Athena, I think it is. Athena 1 or 2? Yeah, Athena 1 following this service.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is
my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
All right, remain standing, and Dr. Sellers will lead us in the next song.
Receive the benediction. Gracious God, we are grateful for this opportunity to say thanks to this couple that you have placed in this vineyard. We are grateful for their service. We're grateful for Bishop Watson's mind that was filled with good thoughts. We are grateful for his heart that is filled with love. And we are grateful for the paths that he has trod, which remind us of the gospel of peace. Thank you for his leadership. Thank you for his compassion. Thank you for his love for the church and for its people. And now may the grace of Jesus Christ, our Savior, the love of God our Father, the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit, our Comforter, rest, rule, and abide with us now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen.